So yeah, to start off with, I'll go back to probably what it's been near about 10 days now, the T20 World Cup win and the euphoria around it. I had the opportunity to listen to you on other podcasts that you were on very timely. Again, I mean, you probably would have spoken about it a lot. Now, how significant was it? I mean, how important was it? And maybe, you know, there were so many emotions on the players and plus the people who are watching it. I just talked to you about the significance of it. Everybody talked about India deserved it and everything, but the significance for the senior players, the teams there, and having, you know, been coming so close yet so far, the significance of that win.
I think, you know, as the Indian team, there is so much pressure on you to win everything. So, you know, the players after 19th of November, when they kind of couldn't clear that last hurdle against Australia, the pressure was always on India in this World Cup. So I think it was a sigh of relief for the Indian team. But I would like to give this a little more, a little of a like more of a deeper concept, you know. Or a deeper context. Now, if you look at T20, and for example, if you look at the ICC's Future Tours program, annual calendar, and I think the ODIs will and the T20s will start increasing. And India is at the cusp of you know, forming an all-new T20 team. You are seeing what our young team in Zimbabwe is capable of right now. So I think the context was deeper in terms of two senior players phasing out of the team, and then a brand new young team coming into being is always better when that team it comes into being after a victory, you know, because then all the positives are at the bedrock of that new team, and there is no redemption factor for that new team. If that would have been the case if India had lost the final, because people would have said, oh, you know, you had Virat and you had Rohit and you lost the 50 over final, you lost the T20 final, now here is a team and all the pressure is on that team to redeem themselves. So that redemption factor is in there. So now I think we will go in with a brand new T20 team and try and put distance amongst us and the rest of the world, because I think that is a distinct possibility. Because Australia will also go through a lot of changes. You'll have three or four of their players phasing out, two or three of the English players also phasing out probably. So this is a good time for a young Indian team to come in and you know, stamp themselves as the best team in the world.
Absolutely, and the future definitely seems bright for this Indian team despite the retirements of the senior pros that you mentioned. So yeah, just looking at four debutants we have had for India in the two Zimbabwe T20s that have played out, Abhishek, Rehan, Dhruv, and Sudarshan, each having their own strengths. And you've been a selector, you've been part of the CAC, you've seen these players and the entire Indian setup, you know, taking them forward. Who among these four, I mean, or maybe anyone outside this group also, you think is definitely in for the long haul?
Yeah, I think you know, there are two or three players who are in for the long haul across formats. So if you look at Rituraj Gaikwad, Jaiswal, these are guys who will be you know, lambi race ke ghode across the formats. For the T20 format, apart from the names you took, I think Tilak Varma is a fantastic prospect as well, because he can bowl, and we need somebody at 5 or 6 who can bowl. The problem with the Indian team has been that of the sixth bowler. So I think Tilak Varma fits well into that role. But the rest of the guys are all fantastic. I think you will now see a brand new batting lineup with one or two points of stability. Will be that Rishabh Pant will bat number 3, you know, Sky will bat 4 and Hardik will bat 5. So you will see that emerging as the new backbone of the Indian team, which currently had Virat and Rohit as the backbone. But the three names that I mentioned, Pant at 3, Sky at 4 and Hardik at 5, will form that new backbone.
Definitely. And the other important aspect is with Rohit Sharma, you know, quitting the T20 format, the captaincy. I mean, there's a vacancy there. Hardik seemed to be an obvious choice, seems to be. But Do you think that's straightforward a choice? You know, you're seeing Shubman Gill leading the T20 in Zimbabwe. The name of KL Rahul is also there in the mix. So how do you think, you know, India will go, you know, forward with this? Because it's pretty much certain Rohit Sharma will be there for the ODIs and the test, and T20 will have somebody different. So there are different captains for white ball and red ball cricket.
Yeah, I think Hardik Pandya will be the natural choice. I think Rishabh Pant will then become his vice captain, according to me. But there are four players in the actual captaincy stakes going into the future. And that's Hardik Pandya, Rishabh Pant, Shreyas Iyer and KL Rahul. Let's not forget that KL Rahul is a fantastic player. There have been some reports about him not being available for ODI cricket. I'm not sure how authentic they are, but he is again a cross format player. So here are the four names. I think Shreyas Iyer will need to cement his place in the T20 side before he can be thought of as a captain. But here are the four young leaders, and we are seeing them in the IPL as well. So here are the four young leaders, and one of them will be the guy for the long term.
We most definitely have a long, you know, strong bench strength when it comes to batting. But what about bowling? I mean, there's Shami at 33, Bumrah is 30, so is Siraj. I mean, still 2-3 years' time before India should start seriously looking for replacement. But among the current lot, I mean, Arshdeep Singh, you've been seeing how impressive he has been under pressure. You have an Avesh, you have a Khalil, all of those guys coming. Guys like Harshit Rana, you know, doing so well in IPL. There's a tearaway pacer named Mayank Yadav. We don't know what the future holds for that. The young boy. But then again, how impressed are you, and who do you consider among these young lot the most, you know, likely to be the successors to a Bumrah, a Suraj or a Shami?
I think apart from the names that you mentioned, I feel Avesh Khan is a very, very good prospect. I also think Khalil, if he can keep moving the ball consistently, is somebody who is who's an interesting prospect as well. So I'm not really worried from a fast bowling perspective, but I think we need to now look at a couple of other wrist spinners as well. Maybe a direct replacement for Jadeja is probably Akshar Patel. So we are lucky from that perspective, but there will be one gap in the team, which is a batsman who bowls regularly. And I think that is why they tried Shivam Dubey as well this time, hoping that Shivam Dubey can in the future also hold his spot. But I think Tilak Verma there is another prospect. So from a fast bowling perspective, to answer your question, I'm not worried. There are five or six bowlers who can step into the shoes. I think it's going to be interesting on how the BCCI plans the next 2 or 3 years of cricket, because coming up in December is a big series in Australia. In 2025, India go to England for a big series, so they will want to keep Shami and Bumrah fresh, for that series. So you will see a lot of rotation, a lot of workload management happening right now. But overall, we seem to be in a very, very good shape going into the next 10 years. Wherein, let's not forget that cricket will also become an Olympic sport. So it will assume greater proportions globally. So all in all, a good time for India, set up by that fantastic win, in the Caribbean.
Right. And in that batters who can bowl, I think Abhishek Sharma is also a very, interesting choice there. I mean, just on that Yuvraj Singh mold, it seems.
Absolutely right. I mean, you hit the nail on the head. You know, if you have somebody like that opening the batting, and then being able to bowl 3 or 4 overs as well, it's fantastic, right? Remember our 2011 World Cup winning team? You had so many guys, who could
bowl their arms over. Yeah.
You had Sachin, you had Sehwag, you had UV, you had Raina, you had four guys who could literally bowl 40 overs if push comes to shove. Exactly. So that's the kind of versatility the BCCI will be looking for,
absolutely. And when you talk about push comes to shove, it's one area where Indian cricket, it seems that push will come to shove, is wicket keeping. There's an explosion of wicket keepers, so talented young wicket keepers, Rishabh Pant, Kishan Jurel, Samson, Jitesh Sharma. And you all also saw Ritaraj Gaikwad doing a bit of wicket keeping in the, I think, Maharashtra Premier League, if I'm not wrong. There's been an explosion. I mean, what do you see this, you know, the reason behind is it only the Dhoni effect? It's just that, or do you see anything far beyond that?
I think it's the IPL effect, because the IPL teams obviously need keepers. So you need 8x the number of keepers than you needed, you know, before the IPL came around. So obviously, to a certain part, is Mahi's had such a huge legacy on this game. But I think it's due to the IPL.
Due to the IPL, right. Talking about Rohit Sharma, Virat Kohli and Rahul Dravid all retired from the T20 eyes, and hitting from ball one has become a norm now. I mean, you'd see there was a lot of chatter about Virat Kohli and others, you know, who probably play the sheet anchor role or anchor. Plenty has been talked about that. Do you think that a role of an anchor is getting diminished in the T20 format, or is it something that will stay? I mean, it's just like beat ODI or T20, that form of, you know, play will definitely remain.
I think an anchor in the 50 overs format is needed. If you ask me, you need somebody to bat 35-40 overs, and that is there is a true reason, there's a reason for existence for that anchor kind of a profile for the 50 overs game. But for T20 cricket, there's no anchor. Yeah. You just have to go and bang it, basically, you know, from the first ball till the last ball, and just hope that everything connects. So as a batsman, you're hoping everything connects. And as a bowler, you are, saying your Hanuman Chalisa quietly, hoping that the batsman doesn't connect. So it's just a slam bang game. There isn't too much to think about from an anchor perspective. Yes, there is definitely a role for captaincy in a T20 game. And I think we saw Rohit doing that marvelously.
Right. And you talked about there's no space for an anchor in T20, crash and bang. And I mean, somebody like Virat Kohli could do it at this stage. So were you surprised by the kind with him announcing the retirement, looking at his ability and the fitness that he still has?
Yeah, I think, you know, the kind of effort which Virat has put into his career for the last 10 or 12 years, I always felt that he would kind of retire sooner rather than later. So I'm not surprised at all. I think that they still have, both Rohit and Virat still have very strong World Test Championship ambitions. So I think they will be tuning into that now. Playing those 15-20 games lesser a year for India will give their body some breathing space. So I think good decision coming at the right time. We are lucky to have a huge pipeline of players. The BCCI needs to be thanked for that, Vinith, you know, because this pipeline has come about through Under-19 and India A tours. And all these tours need capital. So the BCCI has never shirked from, you know, investing capital into an India A team shadowing the main team in Australia, or an India A team shadowing a main team in England. They've never thought twice about it. So it's not often mentioned, but the BCCI's capital allocation when it comes to development of cricket has been nothing short of fantastic.
Great. Yeah. And it gives me that question. Answer of yours gives me a great segue to my next question. That is, you talked about the pipeline, you talked about the structure, but you need to have somebody to really mold them. And that probably was, you know, no better than Rahul Dravid. And again, we talked about the emotions for Virat Kohli, Rohit Sharma and others. It was 2007 West Indies. Rahul Dravid probably was at his lowest ever as a skipper. And again, you know, so many years later, holding that trophy, the emotions. Just talk to me about the highlights of Rahul Dravid as a head coach. What would you think? He recently believed that, you know, judging a coach just purely on the results is not the right thing. It's about the environment, the success, building connections. Just your thoughts on Rahul Dravid's tenure as a coach, because he was under fire a lot of times, but I think probably was the right way to end that tenure for him as well.
I think what I said to start off the conversation is the platform, the floor plate which the Indian team has now with this victory to go on and become the best team in the world across formats. Now, I'm not saying this as an Indian who loves his country and loves his team, but I think the Indian team really has a very authentic and achievable opportunity of being the best team across formats by a distance. Now, when you double click on why this has happened, then you go back to the 5 years which Ravi Shastri was the coach and the 3 years which Rahul Dravid was the coach, and you know how they've brought about this entire culture of one team, how they've channeled the right players from the Indian A setup into the team. You know, all these small things don't get spoken about. So Rahul is right when you say that you can't judge a coach by the results, but I would actually say that he's done a fantastic job because he has enabled this springboard. So whoever becomes the next coach has a real opportunity to put distance between India and the next team. And like I said, with the Olympics also embracing cricket, the relevance of cricket will go up across the world. So the responsibility or the expectation from an Indian team will also get bigger. And I think Rahul has left them at, not left them as in not relieved, but he has brought them to a stage where all these audacious goals look possible.
Right. And that's Rahul Dravid for you, right? So that brings me to the next question. You're part of the CAC, Cricket Advisory Committee, looking at the next Indian coach. You had done interviews and all. It was a very, comprehensive JD for the Indian coach. What do you look in the ideal candidate, so to speak? You talked about Rahul Dravid, the candidate, and also is that the blueprint you follow, or is no? It's not like for everyone is different, and whoever you interview is different.
Yeah, I think it depends on where you are as a team. You know, so 3 years back we were in a different place as a team where we were ready to take on this mantle because we'd just beaten Australia. I think that was one of Ravi's last series. And then Rahul was taking the team from there on. So it depends on where you are. So for me, the next 3 or 4 years, the ICC already has their future tours program. So for me, it's a question of how is the coach going to think about this bank of players, this bank of amazing talent that that whoever it is will inherit. And then how is he going to put this bank and have the ideal flying formation beneath across test matches, ODIs and T20s? How is he going to manage the workloads of the Bumrahs, of the Shamis, of the world beaters? Let's not forget that India will have at least two great bowlers in their lineup in test matches. The third one is R. Ashwin. For example, so it's so how is he going to manage these champions and provide some longevity so that you reach the 2027 World Cup, ODI World Cup in a position of strength, you reach the 2026 World Cup, T20 in a position of strength, and the 28 World Cup. So these are all the things which really excite me on how that candidate is thinking in terms of how is he going to manage that human capital. And how is he going to strengthen that human capital for the next 3 or 4 years of his term?
Right. One final question, Jatin. India and cricket always go hand in hand, and we can go on and on and on about cricket. It's a never-ending topic, but often it leads to other sports getting a bit sidelined. But there's always potential for India to do well in other sports, looking at the size, the ability, the potential the country has. And sometimes it feels like it just needs that right direction or right push in that right direction. You've been part of an organization which looks at stuff like that. Can you just speak about that a bit more?
Yeah, I run a sports app called Khelo More. You can find it on the App Store. Basically, what we are trying to do is bring access to sport very easily to Indians. So if you want to play a game of box cricket, Vineet, for example, and you're wondering which box cricket venue do I go to, you can just enter your current location and Khelo More's app will throw up 6 or 7 venues around you, and you can go and book slots at those venues. Similarly, badminton venues, football venues. So we're aggregating the supply side of sport and we've put it on one app. And to your earlier question, about other sports, there's such a huge eruption in sports participation in India at all levels, right from middle-aged people who are playing recreationally to to children from schools, from tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns. Everybody is willing to play sport. And I will tell you one thing, that after these Paris Olympics, the crescendo will rise even higher. So it becomes incumbent on a sports loving person like me to ensure that millions of Indians get access to sport. And that's what Khelomore is trying to do. Right now, we have a great app which allows you to book sports venues. In the next 2-3 months, we will enable you to book thousands of certified coaches across sports as well. So we are here to ignite your journey into sport.
Great, great. Fantastic. And I hope, you know, India also achieve great heights as it has achieved in cricket as well. And thank you. Thank you, Jatin, for your time. It was fantastic speaking to you, and all the best for your endeavors as well.
Thank you so much, Vineet. Really enjoyed it. And hope we can speak soon again. Thanks.
Most definitely. Most definitely. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Bye-bye. Bye.